So here's what we're going to do. First thing we're going to note is that if each of these things could be represented by a bag of vectors, max over a bag of vectors, then all the other ones could also be represented as max over a bag of vectors. So the easiest one is the very first one. The first one says that the value function at time step t is the max over actions of some other kind of thing. If this is represented as the max of a bunch of dot products over belief states, then think about what happens if you just take all the vectors for all the different actions and throw them into one big bag. So imagine that we've got, you know, one set of vectors that represents a value function, and then we have another set of vectors, this is for one particular action, then we have a set of vectors that represent the value function for a different action, call it A2. So the thing to note is that the max over the bag of vectors, this upper surface here, is actually the right thing. That if A1 gives the highest answer in one case, then we get that. If A2 gives a higher answer in another case, we get that. We can just pool all the vectors together. So this is just a union over all actions of the bag of vectors for each of those actions. This is a way of writing max as an operation over sets of vectors.
Sure, I believe that. That all makes sense.
The next piece is that the value function for an action A at time step T for belief state B, we said that it was the sum over observations of some particular vector that we get for that observation. If these can be represented using bags of vectors, then this sum over observations can also be represented using operations over bags of vectors. And in particular, what we end up having to do is take those bags of vectors and compute what I like to call a cross sum. It's basically the sum where we choose for each of the observations, we choose a vector, and then we add those vectors together. It ends up producing the same effect as this sum. So what we're doing here is now, given a set of vectors, one set for each action observation pair, we're going to create a bag of vectors just for an action by taking this sort of cross sum, summing out all the different observations. Because that's really what we're doing. We're summing out over the observations.
So that's just really a fancy way of writing what you just wrote.
Yeah, but again, it's letting us go from this function V, which is over an infinite state space B, to just a finite set of vectors. We have a set of vectors, and we generate from that a new finite set of vectors. So in this case, the number of vectors, this first step, the number of vectors is the sum of the size of the some number of vectors in all the sets, gamma AT. Here, we're actually multiplying. So it's the product of the sizes of all these sets, which is finite, but it could get actually quite big.
I guess now that you say that, you should say out loud that you're making assumptions that everything else is finite too, like the number of actions and things like that.
Sure. That was already built into the definition of MDPs, the way we were talking about them.
Fair enough.
But yeah, it's probably worth repeating that certainly if the number of actions is infinite, then this is problematic. This union is problematic. And if the number of observations is infinite, then this cross sum is problematic. So we're finite state space, finite action space, finite observation space.
Okay, so I'm getting the idea. Basically, that if you can start out with something finite, at every step of the way, you might grow, but you're never going to grow an infinite amount in a single step. And therefore, so long as the number of steps is finite or bounded or some word like that, you will maintain a finite number of things in your bag. That's kind of what you're doing step by step. Okay.
That's what we're going. And if it feels like there could be a lot of vectors, this is true. It actually can grow doubly exponentially with t, the number of iterations of value iteration we're doing. But for now, we're pretending that's not a problem.
Yeah, I mean, look, exponential is bad unless you're comparing it to infinite.
That's right. We set things up so that exponential is actually awesome.
Yeah, because it's finite.